Morning.
Good morning.
How's everybody?
Good.
Good, good, good. So
good. Thank you. How are you?
I'm good too. Thank you very much. And some folks are having a cold spell. I hope you are not one of those people in that area around the country. And if you are, that you are doing the best you can to stay warm.
Yeah.
All right. So.
That's right.
All right. So, Mike, where are you? You're always in a different place.
Yes.
So, like when you're in church, what happens is people tend to sit in the same place all the time, right? You know, you notice yes. that they sit in the same place, you know, same. I'm on this side of the room, on that side, I sit in the front or the back or wherever. We always find our place and we go there every time. But on Zoom, you're never in the same place. Sometimes during the same meeting.
Right.
So you just keep moving around.
Yeah.
Anyway, so that's part of the fun of it. All right. So, Mike, you want to get us started, please? Good morning, yes. Madeline. Nice to
yes,
see you.
Yes. And good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us in the spirit of perfect harmony. On this beautiful Valentine's Day 2021, we are the Center for Spiritual Living West Georgia. We study and practice the philosophy and science of the mind we know as God. And with our spiritual presence and our participation in our service this morning, we create a higher state of consciousness, rise above any negative energy that may have prevailed this past week, and manifest love. Love is synonymous to God, as we know. Our master teacher, Reverend Dr. Sandra Jackson, will now proceed with our service.
Reverend? Okay, thank you so much, Mike. Good morning again, everybody. Let us take a moment, put those cups down, turn our self within, close our eyes if we feel comfortable. I hope you feel comfortable closing your eyes in your own home. So, and just take a deep breath and just breathe, breathe in and breathe out. And allow yourself to become centered in this moment. Relax into your chair, or your sofa, wherever you are being comfortable, even in your bed. Just allow yourself to be present, be comfortable, and be right there. Be in this moment. Breathe again, relaxing, releasing, and letting go. And it is through letting go of the outer world of effects that we allow ourselves to turn within and we find that big, deep well of possibility, of joy, of the love that Mike was talking about. This is where it is born. This is where it is created. This is its source. And this is where we find, this is where we get in touch with the truth of who and what we are, the life that we are living, and the value that we are in the world comes from this source that is within us. It is our power, it is our strength, it is our wisdom, it is our intelligence and our creativity. And without it, we have nothing. And so this morning, we are just allowing ourselves to open fully and completely with deep gratitude and thanksgiving that we have this connection, that we not only have it, but we know it. So many people have it and don't know it. In this moment, let us just know that this is who we are. That wherever we are, whatever our circumstances, whatever the conditions of our life, regardless of how much abundance or lack of it, regardless of how much joy or lack of love or anything that we think we are in lack of or fear of, it is now dissolved into the gratitude of knowing that we have this well of goodness that is always, always there. And all we need to do is just simply take a breath, close our eyes and turn within and be in touch with that well of love, of peace, of inspiration, of joy, of wisdom, of creativity, of anything we so desire. And so I speak my word now, knowing that this is the truth of each and every one of us. And we, as we come together as community today, regardless of where we are coming together in community, knowing this truth, and it uplifts each and every one of us because we have had the opportunity to be together this day. We release and let go all sense of time and space and just allow ourselves now to know that God is all, in all, through all, and as all. And consequently, we are one. And so it is. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, so let us begin today. Good morning, everybody. It's good to see you all. And happy Valentine's Day. Yay! Okay. And we have something special today to celebrate. It's Marsha's birthday. So today, right, Marsha? Or was it yesterday? It's today. What day? Whose birthday is today? Somebody's birthday is today. Did I miss that?
Mine was yesterday.
Zizi. Sorry about that. Zizi's birthday was yesterday. I should remember that. We celebrated her 30th birthday in Half Moon Bay on the beach, and it was Friday the 13th with a full moon. I should never forget that.
And we had 13 people there. So it was beautiful. Thank you.
Okay, thank you so much. All right, happy birthday, Zizi. All right, Marsha, take it away.
Okay, good morning. I was like, whoa, my birthday? What? So, all right.
It's somebody's birthday.
Well, it's Daryl's birthday tomorrow, so.
Okay, well, let's wish Daryl happy birthday, too.
I will let him know. All right, so our vision and our mission statement, CSL West Georgia is a joyful global community where everyone belongs. Through our unique spiritual teachings, we provide a safe environment to experience compassionate living. And our declaration of principles, I believe in the unity of all life and the highest God, and that the highest God and the innermost God is one God. There is one life, which I am a part, one intelligence, which I use, one substance which takes form as my life. And so it is.
And so it is. Okay, so this morning, Susan is back with us. Yay! All right, Susan, all the way from California. Thanks for getting up early this morning.
You're welcome. Thanks for having me. Happy Valentine's Day, everybody.
Hi. I wanted to say that I'm so grateful to have my good friend, Susan Mohini Kane, with us again. She is a classically trained singer, a songwriter, author. What, your book was 21st Century Singer?
Singer. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. and she's just started a new business called Santosha Voice Group. And she has got a special invitation just for us today. She is going to be live on Patron Wednesdays at 3 o'clock our time, noon West Coast time. I don't know what time that is for ZZ. 2, something like that. And she is just inviting a few people to come and hear her sing songs. So we are so grateful for that. Thank you, Susan.
Yeah, I'd love to have you. It's 10-minute midweek musical picker-upper. And maybe I'll put the link in the chat for you guys.
Put the link in the chat for us. Yeah.
I will.
Thanks. And ZZ's awesome. On California time. So just
think. Awesome. Right? ZZ, I'll see you there, hopefully.
Just shake your head. Yeah.
She's in the back. Yeah. Awesome. All right. So thank you. Thank you so much. And Cynthia and I wrote this song I'm going to sing for you today. You are the first people to hear it. It's Love, Love. And it's for Valentine's Day. So here we go. Out of love, seasons change their colors, and strangers turn into lovers, and twilight becomes the dawn. Out of love, the wind just keeps on blowing, and flowers keep on growing, and good is worshipped all day long. Oh, love, love, it's all that makes the world go round and round. Oh, love, 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 oh, love, love, it's all that makes the world go round. Out of love, plants grow higher and higher, and embers burst into fire, and earth can offer up her gold. Oh, love, rivers flow to the ocean, and hard hearts finally open, and acorn becomes an oak. Oh, love, love, it's all that makes the world go round and round. Oh, love, 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 oh, love, love, it's all that makes the world go round. Everybody loves a little, everybody loves a lot. Neighbors feel alone, and sometimes friends can feel forgot. You can do your part with just a little bit of love. Open up your heart, take strength from above. Love, love, it's all that makes the world go round and round. Oh, love, 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 oh, love, love, it's all that makes the world go round. It's all that makes the world go round. It's all that makes the world go round.
All right. Love. Thank you, Susan. All right.
Thank you. Chewing up.
All right. Isn't it wonderful when songs are true songs too? Okay, this morning's reading is done by Sandy. And, you know, she could still use some volunteers. She did last week's reading, and we love her voice, and we love having her read, but it's so wonderful if other people volunteer too. So, okay, go, Sandy. I think we can't hear you. It looks like you're not mute. You're still muted. The thing says you're muted. Yeah, there you go. Say something now. The little red mute thing is off.
She's having other issues. Yeah.
Work on that. I'll be right back.
Okay. Well, like, Sandy.
Uh-oh. No reading this morning.
I get what you're saying. Whoa. Okay. Sandy, what did something become unplugged maybe? Okay. Yeah, your sound is gone. And well, let's good.
All right. I have the reading.
Okay, good.
Okay, so let's man is ever in search of strength. It is the strong man that wins. It is the man with power that scales the heights. To be strong is to be great, and it is the privilege of greatness to satisfy every desire, every aspiration, and every need. But strength is not for the few alone. It is for all, and the way of strength is simple. Proceed this very moment to the mountaintops of strength that you now possess, and whatever may happen, do not come down. Do not weaken under adversity. Resolve to remain as determined, and as highly enthused during the darkest night of adversity as you are during the sunniest day of prosperity. Do not feel disappointed when things seem disappointing. Keep the eye single upon the same brilliant future, regardless of circumstances, conditions, or events. Do not lose heart when things go wrong. Continue undisturbed in your original resolve to make all things go right. To be overcome by adversity and threatening failure is to lose strength. To always remain in the same lofty, determined mood is to constantly grow in strength. The man or woman who never weakens when things are against him or her or them will grow stronger and stronger until all things will delight for them. He, she, them, will, they, will finally have all the strength they may need, desire. Be always strong and you will always be stronger. And that's from Your Forces and How to Use Them by Christian D. Larson. See how easy that is to read? So volunteer somebody. You'll have more advanced notice than I just did. Okay. So let's begin. Such is life. That's a really good reading for just right now. Because that's adversity, right? We had to make a change. And we can't get all upset and discombobulated and all, you know, it's like, oh, my whole life's falling apart because this little thing happened and it was unexpected. We have to be willing to make changes and to move quickly and, you know, adeptly. So in December, we did candle lighting service. And in the candle lighting service, I talked about 12 qualities that we needed in order to develop our spiritual strength and wisdom and creativity and to live a more spiritual life. The first one was faith. Guess what the second one was? Strength. And that's what we're talking about this month. Strength. Having the strength to do, the courage to do what we want to do and to move through the adversity. Because believe me, you will find adversity. If you have a desire for something, you will find adversity. It will show up in your life. You know, it seems like it's almost a law. If I desire something great and lofty and I have to make some changes in my life in order to get it, then I must go through some adversity so that I may demonstrate my faith and my strength and my courage through whatever is going on, so I may feel worthy and deserving of that which I desire. Well, the fact of the matter is, if you have a desire for it, you're already deserving of it. but most of us have adversities in our life because we don't believe that we have that that comes to us with that much ease. And yet at the same time, life itself presents us with adversities that we just can't, we can't foresee sometimes, like the pandemic. You know, we're all dealing with this, and there are people who predicted it, but then there are people who were in positions that knew that it was going to happen and did nothing. But the most of us, you and I didn't know about it. And so that was life presenting us with an adversity to whatever is going on in our personal lives that we all have to deal with. You see what I'm saying? So while we have our individual adversities, we also have our collective adversities as well. So I want to talk a little bit about one of Dr. King's mentors. Everybody is like, we acknowledge Dr. King for nonviolence. He has a nonviolence institute. They have a lot of information about nonviolence on his website. If you want to know about nonviolence, you go to the source, that's Dr. King. But Dr. King had his teachers. And one of his teachers, along with Gandhi, was Dr. Howard Thurman. Dr. Howard Thurman, as it turned out, was the dean at the chapel when my mother was at Howard University. He was there at Howard University during the shooting. He was also one of Dr. King's teachers at the Boston University when Dr. King was there. And so I want to talk a little bit about Dr. Thurman today, because he was a Baptist theologian, and he started a multicultural church in San Francisco, one of the very first in the country. He was born in 1899. He died, actually, he's just a few weeks older than my grandmother. My grandma was born in 1892. He was born in November, she was born in December. Anyway, they both passed away now. He was 81, he died in 1981. But he had a church in San Francisco, which a friend of mine became the minister of, so I got a chance to go there when he was installed. And he had this wonderful church, as a wonderful multicultural church where at the time in the 50s, people did not go to church together. White people and Black people did not go to church together, not to worship, okay? Black people went to their church, white people went to their church. And that was pretty much it. But at any rate, in 1935, he went on a tour of India, Burma, and Ceylon. And he was at the University of Colombo in Ceylon when he gave a talk at the law school there. And afterwards, the principal of the school came, you know, asked him if he could have brunch, you know, to have coffee with him. And so he said yes, and they went and sat down and they talked for a little while. And then the principal asked him, "What are you doing over here?" And he says, he was with a group that was on a pilgrimage, and the principal wanted to know, but you know why? So I don't know, because they don't tell in the story who the other people were, but I have a feeling that Dr. Thurman was the only Black person in a group of white people. At any rate, he had finished this talk. And so this is what the principal said to him. "More than 300 years ago, your forefathers were taken from the western coast of Africa as slaves. The people who dealt in the slave traffic were Christians. One of your famous Christian hymn writers, Sir John Newton, made his money from the sale of slaves to the New World. He is the man who wrote 'How Sweet the Name of Jesus Sounds' and 'Amazing Grace.' There are many others, but these are the only ones I know. The name of one of the famous British slave vessels was Jesus. The men who bought the slaves were Christians. Christian ministers, quoting the Christian apostle Paul, gave the sanction of religion to the system of slavery. Some 70 years or more ago, you were freed by a man who was not a professing Christian, but was rather the spearhead of certain political, social, and economic forces, the significance of which he himself did not understand. During all this period, since you have lived in a Christian nation in which you are segregated, lynched, and burned, even in the church, I understand there is segregation. One of my students who went to your country sent me a clipping telling about a Christian church in which the regular Sunday worship was interrupted so many times so that many could join a mob against one of your fellows. When he had been caught and done to death, they came back to resume their worship of their Christian God. He said, I am a Hindu. I do not understand. How can you possibly continue to be a Christian? That became the book by Howard Thurman, Jesus and the Disinherited. And Thurman looked at Christianity and he looked at Jesus in a different way than most of the Christians. And that is reason why he could go to India and Burma and Ceylon and talk about civil rights in the United States. You see, he looked at Jesus in Jesus's environment. Jesus, we celebrated Christmas, you know, and we always celebrate Jesus as though he's something other than what he really was. And what he really was poor. His family was poor. And there's, you know, I'm not gonna go into all the things because Howard Thurman goes in. I don't want to take my time up, tell you all the evidence of that. We can get in the book later if you want to know. I can show you. But Jesus was poor. He came from a poor family. He was Jewish. And at the time, the Jews were what? They were being overrun by the Romans. If we were to look at Jesus with our own terminology, Jesus would be an activist. He would be a non-violent activist. Because he was dealing with systemic problems. He lived in it at a time when there was Roman rule and they were doing everything they could to subjugate the Jews. They did not have the survival of the Jews was even questionable. And as we know, Jews have been chased all over the world, you know, for centuries. And yet at the same time, when Jesus began his ministry, his world was in turmoil. Our world is in turmoil now too, okay? We are having systemic problems. And the thing, what people don't understand about systemic problems is that it's not our fault. We are not to blame. These are things that were here before we came. Like the culture was here when we came, the parents were here when we came, the families were here when we came, everything was here when we got here. So we're not to blame for what, but we are responsible for how we behave now that we are here. We're responsible for how we act now. And Jesus understood this. He was not responsible for what came before him, but he was responsible for what it was he did during the time that he was here. And so he looked at Judaism and he said, you know what, I need to make, you know, we have to understand our religion better. And he looked at the Torah, the Christian, the Jewish teachings, and this is what he came up with as his core teaching. He said to the Jews, hear, O Israel, he's talking to the Jews, the Lord our God is one Lord. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy might and thy neighbor as thyself. The neighbor includes the enemy for Jesus. Because you see, every man is potentially a neighbor. Neighbors are qualitative, not spatial. So it's not about the neighbor who's next to you. It's about the neighbor who lives in the world with you. And so what Jesus is saying here is, hey, yes, glorify God. We have to love God. We have to love God with all our heart, with all our might, with every portion of our being. We have to love God, but we also have to do something else. We have to love the person who is in the world. Now, why do you think Jesus would say something like that? Why does he want you to love everybody? Because here, who's the enemy in his day? The Romans, right? The Romans are the enemy. And he actually healed the Roman soldier's daughter. Okay, so he was proving, the Samaritan, he proved at different times that he could serve the enemy, that the enemy was also his, what, brother. So the thing is that this is where Dr. Thurmond is coming from. He's coming from a place where it's not about the religion that you're teaching. You're looking to the religion and saying, what is the core of what you're teaching? And what Christianity teaches is Jesus's words, and Jesus's words are about what? We're celebrating it today, love. Everybody gets on the love ship on Valentine's Day, right? You can't go into a store without finding hearts. I mean, even the most unlikely store has something about hearts and candy and flowers, and they made a whole industry of it, just like Christmas. But you know, it's like all of it. I walked into Trader Joe's yesterday. They had more red roses than you could buy in a flower store. Okay, because what? Red roses and Valentine's Day go together. But what about tomorrow? What about yesterday? What about next week? What about next month? Are we going to still be loved just because we don't have hearts and flowers and Easter is on its way? Are we going to just forget that, you know what? We're supposed to be loving one another? So what's the good of celebrating love on one day if the rest of the year you're walking around in fear and trepidation and trying to not have your neighbor be the person that you love and reach out to? What's the point? What's the point of loving God and excluding your neighbor? One day, a British cleric who was in India during the time that Gandhi was trying to free the Indian people. There was this cleric, and he was very well known for having an imperialistic persuasion, which means he was all for the British ruling India. And so he came face to face with Gandhi, probably unexpected. And so he was trying to make nice, and he wanted to kind of paper over their differences. You know how people do, you know, when they have differences with you, they don't really want to talk about those differences. They just want to, you know, smooth them over. Okay, so that's what he was doing. And he said to him, you know, find common ground, right? Well, we're both men of God, Mr. Gandhi, aren't we? You are a politician disguised as a man of God. Gandhi replied, I am a man of God disguised as a politician. Do y'all hear that? Do y'all see the distinction? This cleric is saying, we're both men of God. But he is seeing Gandhi as a politician. And then he's disguised as a man of God. In other words, he's saying, you're not really a man of God. You are really a politician, and you're pretending to be a man of God. And Gandhi said, no, don't paint me with that brush. I am a man of God, and I am disguised as a politician. Why is he disguised as a politician? Because he is trying to free his people. And so he must participate in the political arena in order to do what? Free his people. We're doing our best to stay out of politics these days, but we can't. We can't, as spiritual people, we can't stay out of politics. because we have to be people of God disguised as activists trying to help people understand that we are all in this together, and that guess what? Our neighbor is our enemy who we are to love, just like the person we are bringing flowers to today. You see? Think about that. Howard Thurman understood it. He was very clear about why he was a Christian. He was very, very clear about why he was a Christian. And if you read Thurman and you read Dr. King's writings, you will find they were also very good metaphysicians as well. Yes, they were, okay? Joel Goldsmith said, in going within, we do not turn to our own spirituality or to our own goodness or our own strength or our own knowledge, but we go within to unleash the infinite invisible. So he's saying the same thing. Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is one Lord, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart. And we have to go within to find that place where we know the Lord thy God is our God, that the Spirit is who we are, that this is our origin, this is our creative center. This is where our strength is, our wisdom, our creative. This is where we originate. We are people of God. God is expressing itself in us, through us, and as us. Every breath that we take is an indication that that is so. And yet at the same time, we must be like Jesus. We must be activists. Because what did Jesus say? Feed the poor, take care of the hungry, take care of the widow, the orphan, take care of the people who need help, right? He said to the rich man, get rid of your riches and come follow me. In other words, learn what it's like to be the other. Don't just say to the, oh, you're over there and I'm over here, never the twain shall meet. He's saying the other and I are one. If we look at the other and say, you're different than me and there's nothing we have in common, we are doing what? We are ignoring our universal oneness. We're ignoring Jesus's teachings. And that's what Howard Thurman has written this whole book about. It's about learning to love that which is unlovable, the enemy. Because our enemy is the one who's unlovable to us, right? It's easy to love the people we like. There's no big, I mean, there's no adversity in loving the people. I mean, you go out and buy flowers and candy and all kinds of stuff on Valentine's Day for who? The people that you love. But I challenge you with this today. Go buy some candy for somebody you don't like. Go buy some flowers and give them to your quote unquote enemy. Now that's love. That's following the teachings of Jesus. And you know what? If you do that, you will surprise. If they know that you don't like them, you will surprise the out of them. Right? Can't you just see him? What? I thought you didn't like me. Oh, well, really? Oh, I'm so sorry I made that impression on you. If we're going to have a religion, if we're going to have a philosophy, what good is it if we don't practice it? If we don't use it? Howard Thurman practiced it. He created a whole church of multicultural people. He did in San Francisco, by the way. It's probably easier doing it there than it was here in Georgia, because he's a Morehouse graduate, him and Dr. King both. So, you know, no, actually, he was from Florida. Thurman was from Florida, but he went to Morehouse College. To some degree, we're all disinherited. We're all disinherited. And Jesus was ministering to us. We're disinherited if we live in any fear whatsoever. We're in that group of disinherited. Wherever we're impoverished in our lives, we can have money, but we could be impoverished in our relationships or in our health, in our willingness to be of service to other people, in our understanding of ourselves. We're going to be impoverished in those areas. Jesus said, the poor will be with you always. And the people think that means poor people. No, poor in consciousness. If we are poor in consciousness, we are part of the disinherited. We are participating in the systemic disenfranchisement of life to other people if we are not finding that place within ourselves where we unleash the infinite invisible, where we let God be God in us, through us, and as us. If we're not reaching out to the enemy, if we're not looking at the other and saying, you too are one with me. If we're not doing these things, then we're not following the teachings of Jesus. We're not following the teachings of Ernest Holmes. We're not following the teachings of Thurman. We're not following anybody's teachings. That is teaching that love is the way. And it's not an easy path, people. It's not an easy path. It's not an easy path. But we are up to the challenge. Because as Gandhi said, I am a man of God. And if you are a man, a woman, a person of faith, then this is your mission. To find that invisible place within you where the infinite bursts forth in the fullness of life itself and pushes you out into the world to be friend to all, to recognize that everyone in the world is your neighbor, that no one is an enemy. And where you find that you have difficulty, then there's the place, note this, where forgiveness is necessary. There's forgiveness that is necessary. We could talk about that some other time. For now, let's just close our eyes and turn within. And today we pray, we open our hearts, our minds, and our lives to have the strength, courage, the wisdom to turn within and to let ourselves truly be a person of God, to love God, to love spirit, to love whatever name we call that infinite, to let it be in us the fullness, the completeness, and the totality of our being, to connect with it in a way that we are never separated from it. That it is moment by moment moving in us and through us and as us. And every time we take a breath, there's some place in us where we know this is our truth. Even when we're not doing it consciously, even when we're sleeping, even when we're driving and our focus is on the road, even in those moments, even in the midst of an argument with someone, even when we are down in the very depths of our sadness, our fear, and our unhappiness, there is that within us that we connect with and know that there is only one life. That life is God's life flowing in me, through me, and as me in every way possible. That whatever my experience is in this moment, that something great and magnificent is from within me, is giving me strength and birthing me anew and creating a life for me that is the life of my heart's desire. That at all moments of every day, I am knowing the truth of who I am. That forgetting is only an appearance of forgetting. It is not the truth. I always know who I am. And so I am speaking this word and knowing that it is our truth. It is our truth collectively. It is our truth individually. It is the truth of everyone in our world. Because we know if we are one together, then everyone in the world is one with us too. And there is no enemy. There is no friend. There is only oneness in God. And we stop making distinctions between who is friend, who is lover, who is enemy, who is one, who is not. We are all together as one. And from this moment on, we see it, we feel it, we create it, we know it in the very core of our being. And every activity of our life demonstrates the truth of who we are. And so today we give thanks that this is who we are. We give thanks that we have the possibility of knowing this, because there's so many people who don't. And so because we know it, we practice it and we be it. And so it is with deep gratitude and thanksgiving for this and so much more that I release this word now, knowing it is done, that it is the law of our being. Each and every one of us is the law of who and what we are. It is the law that is expressing its way in the world by means of each and every one of us. And so we appear in separate bodies, in separate places, in separate lives. We are truly one in consciousness, in wholeness, in peace, in love, and the knowingness that truly God is in us, through us, and as us. And so it is. Amen.
Path of love, fill me with strength, fill me with patience. Fill me with love that's ever after in my heart. Path of love, show me the ocean that's within me. Show me the waves that ebb and flow upon the shore. Path of love, make me strong, show me I'm one with you, with my brothers and sisters too. Path of love, make me strong, work through the songs I sing, let me see you in everything. If something's wrong or if it's right, but I know it's there. If I have faith, you'll show me the way. Light of love, shine through my eyes and through my actions. Shine through my gifts and through the song that's in my heart. light of love. Shine through the sounds of birds and children. Shine in the endless velvet world behind my eyes. Light of love, shine through me. Show me I'm one with you, with my brother and sister too. Light of love, shine through me. Let me dissolve in you. Let the world revolve around you. Shine through me. Shine through me. Light of love. Shine.
That's what love does. It shines through us, right? Yes. Oh, yes, thanks. And when we let our light shine in love, we attract that which is loving. Marsha, take it away.
Good morning again, everyone. Good morning. Excuse me. So now is the time to gather together and take part in our conscious giving moments. So as always, I love to share with you the ways that you can donate to the center and support the ministry. So there are three ways. The first way is to, if you feel so led to make an online payment, we use PayPal at the moment. So there's a link. As soon as I'm done talking, I forgot to put it in the chat window again, but it's in the newsletter and it will be in the chat window. If you feel more comfortable sending a check, our mailing address is on the screen and it will be on the chat window in a moment. And if you are an Amazon shopper, Amazon has a charitable program where they take the amount of money that you spend with them and they give a portion of that to your chosen charitable program. So the link will be in the chat window to connect with us if you have not already done so. And then you just go to smile.amazon.com and then Amazon takes it from there. So those are our ways to donate to the ministry. And let's all come together and have our affirmation. I am grateful for the divine givingness circulating abundantly through my life, my community, and my world. So it is. Thank you.
Thank you, Marsha. Okay, so our announcements. We have a board meeting today and everyone is invited. So if you want to come, we start at 12:30. Just if you go out of the meeting, just use the same link to log back in, or you can just turn off your sound and your video and do what you need to do to have some lunch or whatever, and then come back at 12:30. It usually lasts an hour and a half or so. Come and stay as long as you would like to stay. Okay. Our board members are Marsha, raise your hand, and Zizi, raise your hand, and Deborah is with a name down there, okay, and Sandy is our new board president, yay, all right, okay, so, and we want to just acknowledge Lily. She has served for over a year and she has decided to, there's Kathy. Hadn't seen you, Kathy. Hi, Kathy. She's our other board member. And Lily just resigned from the board. She served for over a year. And so we just want to acknowledge her and thank her. She came on board just when I was first starting here, and she gave us a good boost as secretary. And we're just so happy that she was able to serve as long as she was. So thank you, Lily. But that leaves an opening on the board, and it's a 3-year term. So if that's something that you think you would like to do, just let us know. Come to a board meeting, see what it's like. Okay, so I think we have a video. Okay, and I'm gonna sit down while we watch it. Okay, all right. Go ahead, Marcia.
Yeah.
Yes, we are all God's children and we all need a prayer to be safe. So thank you so much, Marcia. And FYI, our church donates regularly to an organization that provides food and meals for children. So I should put that in the newsletter. I think I will. Okay, thanks. All right. I love you all and have a safe and wonderful experience for the rest of the day. Go love somebody that, and take up my challenge. Find somebody that you don't necessarily talk to and reach out to them and let them know that you love them. Yeah. And I should say this too. Linda Phillips gave us some very nice things. One of the nice things that she gave us was a very nice 54-inch TV that when we get ready to be in our space, we will have, a nice big screen in order to see ourselves and to continue our coast-to-coast service connections. So thank you so much, Linda. All right. And thank you, Ajika, went over yesterday, and Nelta last Sunday, and Daryl went up and picked up the TV, and
Marcia picked up the TV.
Marcia went Daryl and got the TV. Some work
he had to take care of.
Oh, okay. So Marcia went and got the TV
and the file cabinet.
And the file cabinet too. Uh-huh. So Ronnie, we got the file cabinet. Yay! And it locks. Yes. Because that was one of the things we were going to be asking people for. So Ajika helped a lot with getting her clothes cleaned out and taken to Goodwill. And she had a lot of things that we, myself and Nelda, we filled up our cars with and took to Goodwill. So we helped Cheryl out with that. And I'll probably go over there someday this week and see if there's anything else, but they were using a lot of things to stage. And then when they got finished with the staging, they were going to give some more things away.
So. Yeah. Cheryl said to check back in March, as far as, cause I asked her about one item. She said, everything else. I will say I went through the house yesterday. Mm-hmm. It was very quiet, but I felt her presence, and I just was able to just walk around for a minute and just feel the life that she lived. And I saw the little garden signs that she had about happiness is gardening. And I just really felt that, she was still here, But anyway, I did ask Cheryl about one of the little statues she had. She said everything is pretty much set. I could tell it was set for showing, but check back with her sometime in March,
Well, we'll do that. Yeah. Okay. And so anyway, thank you, Linda.
Yes.
All right. That's our service for today. Everyone have a great week, and I will see you at the board meeting or next week. All right. Thank you. Dorothea, you're supposed to come to the board meeting too.
Bye.
All right. Bye-bye, everybody.